This week's episode takes me back to Europe to explore metal's most over-the-top subgenre, power metal. Power metal is known for its high vocals, epic song arrangements, and Dungeons & Dragons-like band names like Manowar, Hammerfall, and Blind Guardian. It's a metal style that's hugely popular in Europe and seems to bear all of the hallmarks of traditional heavy metal. But oddly, this subgenre is completely alien to me. So what exactly is this thing called power metal? And why has this style remained so mysterious? My exploration of power metal takes me deep into the heart of Slovenia, a tiny European country on the eastern edge of the Alps. Slovenia is home to Metal Camp, an annual three-day celebration of all things power metal.
We are the epic metal warriors from Austria, Austrian metal empire, for honor, glory, strength, beauty, and wisdom.
We're trying to understand what the hell power metal is, because when I grew up, I didn't know what this is. It didn't exist in Canada.
How would you describe power metal, the sound of it?
Girlish. Lots of people who go to festivals have girlfriends and they need a band to show the girlfriend to.
It's called power metal because everybody can scream with it. Strong and fast music with very high vocals.
So why isn't it just called heavy metal?
How would you define power metal? What is it?
Very easy melodies. Very happy melodies. So melodies that you can sing along. Some people still call melodic power metal happy metal.
I was playing dress up, this loud, obnoxious, fun music, the studs and armor plating and stuff like this. And I mean, that's part of the fun.
Power metal, you want to get everybody involved. Every power metal band that enters a stage wants the audience to sing along with them. It's more important than to bang their heads or to, you know, play air guitar.
You see the crowd locked in arms, singing along. It's not an embarrassing thing to be singing along to riffs or solos or lyrics at a power metal show. It's like a big beer hall, soccer hall, chant sort of situation.
Of power metal is this joyous sing-along. It's important to have that feeling of the crowd being with you.
When we compose songs, this is what we have in mind, you know? You want to have a sort of sing-along which people easily can relate to.
It's amazing, you know? You start playing the show and everybody in the audience is singing every single word and it still gives me goosebumps, you know? It's pure magic.
When people go out to a pub in Germany and they have 10 beers, the stuff they can sing must be very simple, as melodic as possible, so everybody can join in, and that's what we call Schlager, and everybody in Germany grew up with that stuff. No one should ask you for the name of the one who tells the story.
See people who are dressed up in battle gear and all of these kinds of things.
That has to do with our history. people looking back to their traditions because they believe in them, because it's just cool to show. If you think of Swedish or Norwegian metal fans, Vikings are really part of their history, a history of horns and swords.
You hear this kind of strange European alchemy going on. You hear melodies, you hear little hints of classical things happening.
Classical music of the 17th century, 18th century, 19th century, many European fans, even if they are rock fans or metal fans, somehow have in their blood. It's something that you hear from parents, from aunts and uncles.
Bach, Paganini, these were the first metallers. For sure, the emotional impact that they were transmitting through the use of the giant orchestras is the same that you can get from a metal band.
There's clearly a strong link between power metal and traditional European music and culture. And this is beginning to explain why this style is so foreign to me. But power metal also emerged in the 1990s, when thrash and glam metal were dead and more mainstream subgenres like grunge were exploding.
Grunge music was all about not being a rock star, not being cool, not being in a party mood, not celebrating what you love.
Classic metal had gotten a bit stale. If you were a band that was playing this kind of classic metal, you were seen as like a dinosaur and something completely out of fashion. It was tough times. It was a time of confusion.
Everybody was saying heavy metal is dead. And I think somehow the crowd was missing this kind of approach, this kind of traditional metal, and they were just looking for a band to come and play that sound.
Take me back to when you guys first started and describe to me, why was it important to you to create the style of music that Hammerfall plays?
We created Hammerfall so that we would have something fun, because nobody else did anything on stage or at concerts or albums that we thought was fun. Everything around us was what we did not want music to be. We basically created the band that we wanted to listen to and watch play live ourselves.
Why do you guys think you made that really quite immediate impact?
The metal community was wanting this without even knowing it, probably. I don't think we even expected it until we went on stage for the first time in Germany back in open air in 97. Then that's when we realized, wow, people were actually ready for this type of music. Heeding the call, one and for all. Never surrender, the glory will fall. Brothers unite, let's stand up and fight.
Fulfilling our fate, we are heeding the call. Hammerfall were one of the first bands to bring back rivets and the leather on stage. That's something that, of course, in the grunge times would have been laughable for most of the fans and most of the bands.
What you have is a band saying, we're not going to apologize for any of these cliches anymore. These cliches actually served a whole lot of bands well for 15 or 20 years, and they're gonna serve us well, damn it.
When Hammerfall entered the German charts, heavy metal broke out big again, and they sold a lot of records. Of course, other bands were signed too, from Finland, from Belgium, from Holland, from France. The time was ripe for heavy metal to come back, for real heavy metal to come back.
I now have a better understanding of why Hammerfall and the power metal scene made such a huge impact in Europe during the 90s. But I'm still uncertain about power metal's connection to the history of heavy metal music. What exactly was power metal attempting to revive? Is a subgenre that revived classic heavy metal's obsession with fantasy and European folklore. But this obsession didn't start with bands like Hammerfall. The band that pioneered fantasy metal was Rainbow. Look away from the sea. I can take you anywhere. Spend a vision with me. A chase! So I'm revisiting the interview I did with Rainbow's legendary vocalist, Ronnie James Dio, 5 years before his untimely death in 2010 to understand how he laid the groundwork for the power metal lyrical style.
I read at such an early age and read all about dragons and knights and damsels in distress and great science fiction works. I was just, well, I've got to create what these images are now myself. That's so cool. I decided to put all the things that I wrote in this kind of fantasy area, which made you have to think, what is he talking about? Oh, he said that? Well, I wonder what that looks like. I wanted people to have to use their imagination the way I did and create their own dragons.
You can see, but you're blind. Someone turned the sun around. But you can see in your mind. The gates open.
Rainbow is a direct influence on modern power metal. Probably the main reason would be Ronnie James Dio as a lyricist and this world that he creates of fantasy through songs like Temple of the King, Kill the King, Stargazer, Light in the Black. It's legend and myth, medieval times, Renaissance times.
When you think of the power metal bands, Ronnie James Dio was like a prototype of a lead singer. He was able to define the whole thing of being the singer hero as opposed to a guitar hero.
Ronnie's way of storytelling was really amazing. Everything was left to imagination. It was like painting pictures in somebody else's head.
I've always been a big fantasy fan, and he brought it into hard rock and metal music.
Yeah.
And the horns. Dio brought the horns. Not the Vikings.
No.
Sleep with the devil and then you must pray.
Is a great subject. The symbolism, which is incredible for artwork, for stage presentation, it goes well with black leather and chains and lights and pyrotechnics. It's just a perfect medium for it. Evil is something that we know about but don't understand why it happens and don't really ever meet up with the devil. So again, it's kind of having to use your own imagination.
The power of what has been before rises to trap me within.
While Dio established the power metal lyrical style, the singer who created the blueprint for the power metal vocal delivery was Judas Priest's Rob Halford. Earlier in this series, I explored Priest's role in forging the heavy metal identity. But what was innovative about their music and Rob's approach to metal vocals?
All life, I'm gonna leave it up. Taking my flame, I said I'll never get it up.
I'm always looking to try and experiment. You just want to do as many things as you can possibly do, and you always want to go to 11. You do. Before inner ear monitors, before any decent monitors, you have to scream your throat out just to hear yourself on stage. You know, you're battling against all that volume. I mean, you can't lay back. You've just got to, you've got to rip your throat out.
You got another thing coming!
All of us headbangers as kids, we would sit around and listen to that and go, is this even metal? It was so foreign because Rob Halford was classical, studied, singing high almost all the time. Without Rob Halford, you wouldn't have Ralph Sheepers from Primal Fear. You wouldn't have Timo Cotapelto from Stradivarius. Basically, the characteristic power metal vocal almost to the point where it's not power metal if you don't have this kind of vocal.
Judas Priest is more or less the definition of heavy metal, in my opinion.
Yeah, I have to agree with that. I mean, the combination of Halford's singing and Tipton and Downing's guitars,
yes.
That's what made me hooked on them in the beginning.
What did Tipton and Downing do that was different?
If they had only one guitarist, it didn't give you that power metal approach they have. The songs were that good because they have two guitarists playing the same riff in a very tight way at the same moment.
Especially in a live situation. I mean, if you have two guitars, it gives you much more options because if there's just one player and he plays a solo, all the low end, all the bottom is gone because there's no rhythm guitar anymore.
If Ken takes a lead, I can play rhythm, so you don't get something falling out. If I play lead, Ken can play rhythm exactly the same. And then we could do fast harmonies together, you know, which is heavy metal harmony.
I think it's really exciting, two guitar players in the band, when the guys are just like pounding out a riff or just headbanging together.
This ride gears where the talking is. Well, listen, listen, Nate, don't be so anxious, man.
Judas Priest wasn't the only British metal band that used two guitars for added attack and dynamics. In the early 80s, London's Iron Maiden forged a sound that brought a new melodic and epic sensibility to the genre, becoming heavy metal's first sing-along band.
How does melody in the music make the live environment with an audience stronger?
The things what I've always tried to do with Maiden is that basically any guitar melody could be a vocal melody or vice versa. In a lot of countries you go to where they don't, English is not the first language or they don't even speak English at all, they're still singing the melodies. And to me, that says it all, really.
Well, I'd call us old-fashioned, but unless there's a tune, I think I'm probably going home. Any melody is a combination of notes that are exciting or pleasing to the ear, played in a sequence which is also exciting or pleasing to the ear. And that's all it is.
People say Maiden of Metal, it's, I suppose it is, but you have that melodic, almost folky influence.
Try and incorporate melody with power and aggression and the progressive thing. This is what we were trying to do. You have all those elements, it's a pretty potent force.
They're big anthems, so I think they were very special in creating a very epic style of heavy metal.
When I started listening to this kind of music, and I guess most of the other guys that play in power metal bands today too, Maiden has been the big thing. They have been the metal band that kind of unified the whole scene. The kind of band that everybody in the metal scene could agree on.
Was strongly influenced by the classic British heavy metal bands, but most power metal bands are from Germany. So I'm gonna take this time to explore the history of German metal and how it might be related to power metal. And there's no other place to start than the Scorpions.
Tell me a bit about what Germany was like culturally when the Scorpions just started to come up.
Everything we had in Germany was for us, as young guys, terrible. You have to be and work hard and make sure that you have a job which you can maybe do until you are 65. And we said, this is not what we want to do. When I heard the first time Little Richard, Elvis Presley, a third dimension came into my life. Even when we didn't understand the English, we understood the message. Here is a way where we can live our life, enjoy life, and make other people happy.
Why do you think the Scorpions seem to set in motion this whole new movement of German rock and metal?
Because of the history of Germany, we had always the feeling when we came in different countries that we want to show the people there's a new generation coming from Germany, not coming with tanks, coming with guitars and bringing a laugh.
The Scorpions were of absolute importance to me. I was listening to Tokyo Tapes up and down. This album for me was a big revelation as well, like Uli John Roth's guitar playing, having the hard edge and the melody.
Classic
Klaus, Rudolf, and myself, the ones who kind of wrote the music, we were all very melody-driven people. Being a rock band that was really melodic, both in terms of vocal and in terms of dual guitars, was unusual.
It's like delivering great rhythm guitar-orientated music, but at the same time having such extraordinary lead guitar. Klaus Meine has a unique voice that gave confidence to any vocalist in Germany to go different direction and not follow any of the British stereotypes.
I think the Scorpions showed every German band what is possible if you go out and play your music in every little part of the world where it's possible. And they showed all the other German bands what could be done.
The Scorpions blew open the door for future generations of metal musicians to pursue heavy metal music. And then the next German metal band to make their mark on the international stage was Accept.
We always said, okay, we are harder than the Scorpions. That was always our thing to say, okay, we are much heavier than the Scorpions. And I think we were much heavier than the Scorpions. It was really also for the first time that the band was doing really something special on stage. Also clothes by stage clothes. In the beginning I was also in leather and blah blah blah, and then came up this military stuff, and then the whole thing was born.
When I've talked to other bands, they've cited Accept as a big influence.
If you look at Hammerfall live, you will understand that they were a big influence.
Yeah, they were.
With the synchronized movements. And
I remember Udo said once, you know, Oscar, if you're gonna do these movements, make sure that everybody does them in time.
They had this ballet element in their guitar ballet. That was synchronicity and stuff, you know. Priest had that already, but Accept did it even maybe more German, you know, like marching. It gave the band a kind of uniform power coming from the front. You get your balls to the wall.
Progressed, heavier subgenres like thrash metal were on the rise, and bands like Accept and the Scorpions were no longer on the vanguard of heavy metal music. But the German band that embraced metal's faster, more aggressive sound was Helloween.
When people talk, as you know, about Helloween's music, they often say, you know, it was kind of like Iron Maiden, but something a little bit different.
When we did the first, I think it was a mini LP or something, in the magazines, in the reviews, they called us Iron Maiden on speed. And they were definitely not so wrong with that, because we were very Maiden-ish with the twin guitars and stuff. But everything a bit faster, a bit more aggressive.
In the beginning, Helloween was Germany's answer to Iron Maiden, so they had to sound unique somehow. They were the first German band to take traditional heavy metal as we knew it from England back in the early 80s one step further.
The other guitar player, Vicky, was very much the melody guy, and I was more the trash guy, and we put that together.
Keeper albums get held up as very important records. Why do you think those records have been considered in this way?
The two keepers can be seen as the foundation for 90% of melodic power metal bands. So without these two albums, there would have been no Stradivarius, no Sonata Arctica.
There was no one, you know, mingling speed metal elements at that point with Maiden melodies and having some priestish attitude as well. And all with not denying its German roots. In terms of lineage, they would be our direct father.
stop on my journey into power metal takes me all the way to the medieval town of Bologna, Italy, in hopes of meeting up with Swedish guitar legend Yngwie Malmsteen, who took the sound of power metal and transformed it into a neoclassical phenomenon. Although Yngwie is an internationally renowned musician, he isn't the easiest guy to pin down.
It's not easy getting Yngwie Malmsteen. He's a little elusive. We had a plan, we were gonna go to a castle, but now he's not going to the castle until a day after we are here, and it's complicated. He's a bit of a legend. He kinda knows he's a legend. It's part of the problem. He's very aware of it, of his legendness. So, we'll get him. We'll get him. Well, thanks for doing this, Yngwie.
Thank you.
Glad we could make this work.
Me too.
What do you think metal and classical music share? Why do they work well together?
If you listen to Vivaldi and you listen to the melodies and the themes, if you just turn it up and put it through a Marshall stack, it sounds amazing. It lends itself to be played loud.
Were you attracted to classical music because of the virtuosity?
My older brother and sister were playing Tchaikovsky, and I didn't feel like I was gonna be left behind. Like, oh, well, I don't know all that stuff, but I know this blues scale. I'm not saying the blues is bad, it's just I wanna go further.
Malmsteen would quote classical music, he would cover classical songs, he recorded with an orchestra. He was just this intense and intensely European guy. He was probably the guy who made the biggest impact on all the power metal guitarists to come.
Yngwie really established classical influences so much into metal solos with the accuracy and the speed, especially in this kind of controlled wildness in his play. What Blackmore had started, Yngwie took it one or two levels further.
I think it was 9 when Main Japan came out, and I became fanatical about it, and I learned how to play all the parts exactly. So I figured out if you took the LP and put it to the cassette player and replaced left channel with a little microphone, the guitar parts were more or less gone. I would just play everything, and I would take these cassettes around, I would play for my friends, you know. Hey, listen to this. And I go, yeah, it's Main Japan. Is it? Yeah, it's meant. No, it's not. And I would be so proud, you know, because I fooled him.
By combining the influence of Deep Purple with classical music, Yngwie created a sound that hadn't been heard before. But it was one of Yngwie's bandmates who took power metal beyond the realm of the guitar.
What Jens Johansson brought to the Yngwie Malmsteen band and proved to be an enormous influence on the future power metal bands is that he was as virtuosic as Yngwie was.
How did you and Yngwie work together in terms of songwriting and composing the music that you guys made?
We would often sit and get drunk just listening to Paganini. That was like his favorite. And I would like, Paganini sucks, Bach is much better. Like, listen to this, like, oh yeah, it is better, but this is faster. Like, you could have this like interplay between the guitar and keyboards. I would say it's a fuller sound, or more varied sound than you get with two guitars.
I think the difference between Jens and other keyboard players that were around in the late 70s or the early 80s is the fact that Jens played heavy metal. Jens used keyboards as a full instrument. He returned to what John Lord had done with Deep Purple.
About what Deep Purple did, and then you think about what you did with Yngwie. What do you guys think you did that was different?
I think it was harder. Like everything in the 80s got harder. Just a different level of speed, I think, with the solos and tempos.
With Yngwie Malmsteen and Jens Johansson, keyboards was no longer something that we had to apologize for in a metal context.
In the 1980s, Yngwie Malmsteen and Jens Johansson boldly took power metal in a slicker, more keyboard-oriented direction. But then along came Manowar, who created their own subgenre called true metal, a style that brought power metal back to its caveman roots. But even after dozens of phone calls and traveling hundreds of miles to a metal festival in Slovenia to interview Manowar band leader Joey DeMaio, he refused to talk to me. And so I'm going back across the Atlantic to meet with an ex-member to find out something about this band. From the ashes, the clown gathered
dust. So he's in Queens on Metropolitan.
And so I've come to a batting cage of all places here in New York to meet with Ross the Boss, the founding guitarist of Manowar. Because I want to ask him, what did they think of this term true metal?
Power metal, true metal, what is it? What are we? I mean, to me it's rock and roll, heavy metal.
But we wanted to be one step beyond what was happening at the day. One step beyond, let's say, Judas Priest or Iron Maiden. One step beyond the black leather and the chains.
And Manowar, everything was bigger.
Conan the Barbarian combined with the drama of Rainbow and the pure heavy metal of Iron Maiden, and the outcome is Manowar.
Why does Conan and metal work so well together?
Because he's such a kick-ass guy. I mean, you know, he just did what he wanted to do. He didn't follow any rules, and neither do we.
Biceps, sweat, loincloths, three quarters naked women on the album cover. Musically speaking, you know, I mean, Manowar is Manowar, man. I mean, seriously.
They are a very entertaining live band. It's pure machismo, and it's sort of like, I mean, it's also homoerotic, you know. Can't they afford a shirt?
Manowar are talking about true metal. What are they talking about?
Something to delineate between frilly sleeves, keyboard, moat metal, castle metal, Yngwie Malmsteen crushed, you know, velvet jacket metal, and guitar-based biker, loose, jean jacket, leather jacket metal.
Manowar tells you to, you know, go out in the world, kick ass, do what you have to do. Be true. Be true to yourself, be true to your family, be true to your ideals.
So maybe true metal isn't such a bad term after.
I don't think it's such a, now that I'm thinking about it. Light up now!
Through the combined efforts of Manowar and the European power metal bands, by the dawn of the 2000s, power metal had successfully revived the majesty and epic quality of traditional heavy metal. But how does a genre based on nostalgia actually evolve? And then along came England's Dragon Force, who started to redefine the future of power metal.
What was it about power metal that really drew you in?
I think really just like the catchiness of choruses, you know, it's like really happy and uplifting and like, but it was, and it's also most of it's fast. Even though we liked the music a lot, we still thought there was a lot of things that could be a lot cooler about it, you know? So it was like, cause they were always traditionally sort of wore, you know, lace up pirate shirts and pretty nerdy kind of guys, and they're all pretty ugly.
The way Dragon Force came about was I was playing some death metal bands and stuff, and they kept kicking me out saying, oh, there's too much guitar solos, blah, blah, blah. And when we started Dragon Force, I thought, you know what? They're not gonna like us anyway, so let's make it that they definitely don't like us. That's why we're coming up long 8-minute songs. No one really plays solos for like 2 minutes in a 7-minute song. I think the speed came from our, you know, love of like thrash metal. So we've brought in those other influences, kind of like a summary of our lives in metal.
I think metal fans looked at that band and just almost laughed because it just seemed that it was so over the top. If Yngwie himself was an over the top, larger than life figure and a true guitar hero, here were a couple of guys in Topman and Lee who were even faster than Yngwie. They were like an instructional video.
Want to
talk about Guitar Hero.
I guess Guitar Hero has helped bring young people to appreciate guitar solos and good playing.
Even though we hear a lot of the older rock metal fans going, no, no way, these guys don't know anything about music. They got into rock because of Guitar Hero. Times have changed, you know, MTV don't have videos, VH1 less. Video games is kind of a new vehicle for metal music. We need to give people choices for them to decide. And Guitar Hero is a really good vehicle.
Lots of people who are not necessarily into the metal, they're gonna hear it. And it's true, and people did like it. You know, we've seen on, you go on the internet and there's like school choirs singing that song, and like there's like sort of nerdy jazz bands playing it and stuff. And like, that's quite cool, actually.
Through Guitar Hero, Dragon Force introduced power metal to a much broader audience, pushing the genre closer to the mainstream than ever before. But then it was Finland's Nightwish who put power metal on the European charts, taking the genre all the way to number one. Touch me with your love and reveal to me my true name. Oh, how I wish for something. All I wish is to dream again. My loving heart lost in the dark. For hope I give my everything.
What was the sound that you were excited about making?
My biggest passion is film music and soundtracks, which I consider is contemporary classical music. I wanted to do kind of like movie soundtracks, but just in the terms of heavy metal. When you go to the basics of what metal music is, what Black Sabbath did, it's something grand, it's something that's really heavy, pounding, big, grand melodies and riffs. And that's exactly what classical composers like Wagner did.
The whole opera vocal thing for me never worked when I first heard it, but I couldn't stop listening to the damn album. And I couldn't figure out why. Amazingly enough, it has not turned their music into cheese the more that they've put this classical bombast into it, which is very hard to do.
Tends to be a pretty male-dominated style. And do you think part of the reason for the success that you've had has been that you've carved a new direction?
There were many girls before me in the metal, but not kind of voice I had at the time, you know, classically trained. If you listen to Nightwish, it's not the metal that, you know, you consider like a metal. True metal. It's different. So this was the beginning of something new.
It was about time women started to have a sort of like a proactive role within rock music. Young girls who, you know, want to have something else to do with the band other than blow the Guitar Hero, you know.
I only do what I feel. I love the harder riffing in guitars, and I love the symphonic side of the beautiful melodies. It's maybe the matter of fact that having these elements presented in a music that can really reach people, not only the stereotype of a metal fan or classical music listener.
Expanding the sound and audience for power metal, Nightwish and Dragon Force created new possibilities for the future of this style. But two bands can't ensure the survival of an entire genre. So I've returned to the European festival scene to find out what role festivals play in keeping power metal alive.
Festivals like Wacken important for power metal?
A good friend of mine calls that Scandinavian German type music.
Glorious Victorious, those bands, they live with a big scenery. A power metal band you want to see in front of a big crowd. They really work with a big production. Lights, lights, lights. I think that's really good for a live situation.
What would be more perfect than a sunny day in a big festival and a chorus that everybody knows?
The culture of the festivals in Europe is amazing. I mean, when you first come over here, it's astonishing to see so many people. You walk out on stage and there's literally, you see people forever. And that's just something in the US you don't really experience. In Europe, they'll take a whole week off to come to a festival that they're gonna probably watch two bands at. And the whole other time they're camping, having fun with their friends, having a beer. That kind of dedication, you gotta like go, wow, that is cool.
This is just an uncomplicated, fun thing. It's loud, it's obnoxious, it works well with drinking beer. That festival culture is basically a result of stuff like power metal.
I've seen families really coming with the parents and with the children, and you don't know really who is the biggest fan in the family.
It's this unification thing you have. Everybody is into it, everybody is singing, everybody is banging their heads. It's great fun, lots of energy exchange between band and fans, lots of very positive vibes.
Lots of beer and a terrible smell.
I am haunted.
This episode, I set out to understand what power metal is and why it's so foreign to me. And what I've discovered is that while power metal may look and sound just like a heavy metal cliche, it's a movement that revived the traditions of heavy metal back in the 90s when metal in North America had hit its all-time low. But ultimately, power metal has been elusive to me because it's part of the European festival culture. And it's these festivals that will ensure the vitality of power metal and heavy metal as a whole for years to come.